Therefore, I want to give this glory to Heavenly Father. Go into all the world and preach the gospel to every Christian. Mark 16, verse 15. My name is In Song Kim. Actually, I'm from Honolulu, Hawaii, but I was born in Korea in 1960. And I came to Hawaii when I was 11, which is 71. At that time in Hawaii, I used to live in a project home, which is housing, government housing, because we were poor. But there's a lot of Korean people used to live in housing. And at that time, not much Koreans living in Hawaii, not as much as now. So when we used to go to school, we used to get into a lot of trouble because a lot of local people, they used to picking on us. But the place that I live was our village, was all Samoans. You know Samoan? Samoans and Tongan and Hawaiian. And Korean, we get along with them real good, fine. I think that we have the same like culture, right? Be friend. So every school, especially high school, a lot of local people, a lot of especially Japanese local guys used to pick on other Koreans. So there is high school payback. I used to fight for them. Anybody bother Koreans, and I go beat them up. So I was kind of like undefeated. behind that, I have all of my Samoan friend and a Tongan friend. They're all behind me. Therefore, in all the schools, I was doing that for 1 year, 2 years, 3 years. When time passed by, in Hawaii, everybody knew me. Then anybody mess with Koreans, oh, this guy Peho, my nickname is Peho. When you be a gangster, you never use your full name. So, Peho, yeah, Peho coming with Samoans, and yeah, we used to fight with 100 guys like that, you know. So, when I was keeping doing that, and I became real famous in Korean community. And every time I get into trouble, somehow, Korean minister, they're always helping me. Even though I'm wrong, they're still helping me. So at one point, other Korean community, they was talking bad about me and tell the minister not to help me because I'm a like loser, 부재불능, you know? So, but they're still in love me, they still back me up, even though people complain the minister about me. And when I after finished the high school time, and then I became leader of our Korean society gang. And then I start doing crime after that, and make money. I do anything for make money. So I used to work for mafia. This guy named Earl Kim, he was head of the mafia in Hawaii. I used to be his driver, and I was only 16. And I used to carry guns just like everybody else, but I used to get paid like $200 a week. So I used to drive a nice car. All my friends never had a nice car, what do you mean? So I had a nice girlfriend. I had everything nice. So I feel like I'm the toughest guy in the world, richest guy in the world, handsomest guy in the world. So, and then I started doing that, getting into trouble. And I used to tax all the business people, especially nightclub, the bar, or restaurant, they all used to pay me. And then I started moving to hotel. I make the hotel pay me. You call it extortion, right? So I started make the hotel pay me. And then when they don't pay me, usually they don't pay me first time. So we have to make them pay me. So show one example. Example, kill the dog or burn the house or Anybody here have dog? Oh, make sure hide them, yeah? Dr. Lee never had a dog till this time I come, so lucky. Anyway, we kill the dog and burn the house to make them scared. But even if they don't pay that, and then we need to send somebody who hurt them, yeah? When I say hurt, everybody takes it seriously. And then 1983, I got indicted from organized crime tax fraud from the prosecutor office. So 11 of us got indicted. My charge was attempted murder, conspiracy to commit murder, armed robbery, first degree, and all that. It's also in this charge. And when I went to, we all went to prison, me and my all my boys, 11 of us, and I get arrested for gang leader. And when I went to prison, and I was facing life. So, but in the free trial, when they went to the prison, it was only like young kids. And some of my boys was, juvenile. But they said, because the case is so serious, they charged them to the adult. We little kid went to the adult prison. And that time, Hawaii was the worst prison in the US. Yeah. So we all were scared. And when they went to prison, oh, I surprised because, you know, all my neighbors, my Samoan friend, they're running the prison. They're the boss in prison. Oh, so, you know. And then nobody messed around. I had a good time in jail. Because my friend, my neighbors, Samoans, I tell you, they are in prison. Nobody messed with them. So all the Koreans, all of us, we had a good time. Nobody messed with us, and we smoked weed in prison, and you know, we had a good time. But still, the free trial time, inside my heart, I didn't show, but I had a fearness and loneliness because I'm facing life. So that's the first time I think I met God. I think every Sunday, the pastor, they come into the prison, and in the yard, they're having the service going on. But I don't know why I went to their service. All my boys, they didn't go. Me and they get like 500 inmates, but only had like five guys, including me. So, but I had one local Japanese man, the minister was having the service, and in the ending of service, he asked me, that time I cannot speak English. Even now, I speak Pidgin, and after I'm in Cambodia, the Pidgin came more worse. So that time he asked me, are you understand today's service? So I told him, no. He said, you need one, somebody who can speak Korean? So I said, I don't know, I guess. And then 3 days later, one Korean guy walking in the parking lot, all the fans were sitting down, on the rain was sitting down, on my boys. And then next thing you know, the office called me. So when I went to office, it's the same guy was walking, he came visit me. And he said, my name is Lee Won Tae, and I'm a pastor. This is the first time I came to Hawaii. I've been here 2 weeks. So he came there for revival. And then I went back two more weeks later. And then he said that he was talking to me. You know, I guess I was crying to him. I don't know why, but. So he said, well, I'm not coming back to U.S. anymore, so take care of yourself. He left. That was it. And then three months later, oh, he came back. And then he came back and he told me, oh, you know what? I'm going to leave in U.S. because of, I want to help you send gospel to you. And my wife coming 3 months from now, she coming also. And when I went back to Korea, I was thinking about you. Every day I couldn't sleep. I guess, you know, the time that I was crying, he said he remember, he thinking about the moment of I crying. He remembered my face and he couldn't, so he came back. It's for leaving Hawaii. So ever since then, he comes to prison. Every Friday, he comes see me. In prison, visiting is not that easy because something happened in prison. All the time something happened in prison, he come in, they stop visiting, you know, he cannot finish security wise. And then, but he still come every Friday, whether he can come see me or not. So he used to come visit me and he used to so we study Bible together. And meanwhile, they won't give me life if I go to trial and I lose. So I made a deal. So prosecutor asked me on deal, so I got sentenced 25 years. And I went face the parole board, and the parole board, they give me minimum 10 years, which is I have to do 10 years, and 15 years, rest 15 years, I have to go on parole. One guy named Moon, one of my right men, Korean boy, he don't want to go step somebody, he don't want to go shoot somebody and all that. And he turned around and said, I sent him to do it. So, but he got cut. So they give him 5 year probation. So they sent him to the Alaska, he cannot come back to Hawaii. But in the long run, when he went to Alaska, he got married and everything, and then somehow he shot his wife. And she was pregnant. And the bullet entry here, bullet came through here. So he ran away to Korea. On the way, when he coming back, time they arrest him, he got life. He stayed in prison. So actually, he doing more time than me. I mean, yeah. So anyway, after I got 25 to 10 minimum, when I was doing prison time, he comes see me every week. Every week he comes see me and talk to me about God. But sorry, 1 year in, 1 year out that time. You can see my my ear is right through here. Can you see it? So 1 year in, 1 year out. So the pastor and Korean community, they start writing letter to the parole board, release me. Half of the community, they writing parole board, release me. Half of the community tell them not to release me. But the people who write letter to them and call them every day, release me. And I get so much support and so much letter. So first time in Hawaii history, now they're letting me go out in 4 years. Oh, wow. It was 10 years. But don't be happy because I keep coming back. And then I went out, and the day I went out in prison, the cage, oh, I had like 200 boys, all my boys, you know, like mafia type, other boys. Oh, you name, you know, the guy. So 200 boys, almost 200 boys, and plus the TV station, the radio station, they all came. Oh, when I was walking out of prison, oh, I feel like whole world is mine. So I made a tattoo here, the world is mine. I got a tattoo, whole world is mine. I was so happy, you know, like, I don't know, you know, that's all wrong way, but anyway, when I got out, I started going to church in maybe 2 months. 2 months, after 2 months, I stopped going to church. I became more bad because I control everything. I don't need to fight anymore. Every place they pay me. So when I was doing all that, now I will go back for violation, parole violation. So I did 14 months. And I called on Moksanim. Moksanim, I'm in jail again. So he come visit me again. And then after 14 months, I got out, same thing again. And went back to jail again, Moksanim, here I am again. And he come again. It's been 6 times already. Too long, yeah? 지겹죠? 나도 지겨웠어요. So after 6 times, and then I call him. So when I was outside, 5th time around there, I still run the other casino, the illegal casino in Hawaii. And then I had a lot of security, which is all the Samoans in Hawaii, like 300-pound guys, 350-pound guys. They all work for me, right? And then 4 o'clock in the morning, my security called me. And said, hey boss, I said, what's up? He said, one old man looking for you on the street right now. I said, who the old man? He said, we don't know yet. So you should come and check. When I went, there was my Moksanim was looking for me. 4 o'clock in the morning, yeah? And Moksanim see me and he was crying. He said, hey, why you not listening to God? There is God. Why you not stopping this? So I was crying, he was crying, and still 1 year went up. And then after 6 times, when I went back to jail, when I called him, Moksanim, I'm in jail again. And then he said, and then That was like December. I got a letter from Mok Sanim. He never come visit me. The letter said, I give up on you because I'm one human being. Human being only takes so much. And then he said, but God promised me that he gonna answer your prayer. So pray when you feel wanted to pray. I'm retired. Now I'm going back to Korea. So that was the ending. Anyway, when I see that letter, my heart just went drop because I thought this old man, Lee Won-tae, he gonna love me forever. But I made a mistake because human being only takes so much. That's right. And all the Bible study we had, I forgot. And then when I came out, I went back again. When I went back, the time that I get released, it's not like first time. 200 of my boys and all the TV station, everybody, come on news, you know. When I went to jail, seven times coming back out, only my mom. The day I released in prison, only my mom was waiting for me in the gate. And when I got out, and I had to had a problem with the gangsters, but my opposite, so they start shooting at us. So my partner then got killed, and they're supposed to kill me too. And then I went back to jail again for violation. When I went back to jail, that was the last time I went back to jail. When I went back to jail, the people getting released, the time that people getting released, like 3 days, 4 days before, they cannot sleep, you know, they're so happy, excited. Also, I couldn't sleep, not because I was happy, because I know I'm coming back again, and I'm gonna hurt, like my mom hurt a lot of people feeling, I know. So I couldn't sleep also. So 3 days before I come out, in my bed, I saw the letter that my Mok Sanim write to me, say, pray, God gonna answer your prayer. So that's the first time I pray to God. I say, God, must be there's you, because a lot of people that I love, they say there is God. So I'm not gonna believe you. I won't believe the people who I love. They say what they say, I won't believe, not you. But if there is you, why didn't you tell me direction of my life one time? So I start praying, and same thing I pray, and 3 days later, right before I release, I feel answer. I think that's what God answered, I think. I believe he said, if you wanna change your life, leave Hawaii. But leaving Hawaii is not easy for me because I got everything in Hawaii, family, friend, and everything. So I got out in year 2004, May 17, and I made a passport. 3 days later, I left Hawaii to Korea. And I met my wife. My sister introduced me to my wife, and I married her. And she didn't know I'm from prison. And when she saw my tattoo, she said, what is that, this tattoo? I say, yeah, it's gonna go away in 2 years. So she believes that. So that tells you she's very innocent. And then after I married her, but in my heart, my feeling, I go to church and all that, but in my heart, I feel guilty when I think about Lee Won-tae Mok Sanim, because I feel like I owe the guy. He give up on me. Just like I will use him. I cheat on the guy. So I feel always guilty, and I always wanted to talk to him and you know, show him that now I'm not a problem-maker, I'm living normal life. But I couldn't find him, right? In Korea, now another temptation coming to me is, all my gang in Hawaii, they do prison time, and they get sent back to Korea. after 9/11, now U.S. government, they kind of strict on the immigration thing. So small trouble, they send them back. So when me and my wife was living in one place, whole years, I get 2-3 boys from Hawaii. they're living with us, you know? So they're living with us. And me, I came to Korea for the straight life, but these guys, they get, you know, only place they cannot come back is the U.S. They can go to the Mexico, they can go to Canada, and they start being drunk. They go to, they even go to North Korea being drunk. They send them to the Mexico. Eddie not here, eh? So they start doing that, and the police, they investigating me too in Korea. Because I'm there, so I go, now I don't have a place to go now, so what am I going to do this? So I start praying again. And somehow, my mother in Hawaii, she found the Moksanim telephone number in Korea. So it's been over 10 years. So I call Moksanim, hey Moksanim, oh, Jeo, you know, so where have you been? I still pray for you. I was praying even last night for you. Why you came down? You know, why are you now? Why are you, you know, so me and my wife went to see my Moksanim. He living in San, and he was crying and telling my wife that, oh, thank you very much. You trust him and you marry him. My Moksanim said that, my Moksanim telling him, oh, he just like my son. Oh, thank you for marrying him and all, you know. But Moksanim wife, she hates me. Why? Because, you know, in Hawaii, I give him hard time, yeah? So he thought that, she thought that I would give him hard time again. So every time I go visit Moksanim, and then Moksanim told me, oh, Chabu garago, you know, you sleep here, you know, too late. And the someone said, oh, we don't have a place for sleep. And you know, he get treated at the room over there. And then Moksanim go, oh, 밥 먹고 가, you know, and then someone go, oh, we don't have nothing for you. She was doing that, eh? But this moment, she loved me more than Moksanim. So, and then I call Moksanim. Moksanim come in, yeah, 보고 싶어, 이리 와, you know, I miss you. And then I tell her, Moksanim, oh, your wife, you know, somebody know like me. She go, it's okay, we can meet it upside, and we have a date upside. So I was doing that, and then now I talk to him just like my father, and I told him sorry and all that. And I told Moksanim, I don't know if I have to go back to Hawaii, because all my boys came to here, and then I told him about problems, and he said, hey, you know what, don't go back to Hawaii. You go back to Hawaii, it's like you go in jail or you will die. I say, I know that, but you know, even Korea, you know, then, and he told me, all this time, you was living for yourself, you know, selfishness. Why don't you live for someone else? So I said, how long? He said, just 1 month. I said, 30 days. Yeah, I think I can handle. So he said, Cambodia. One of the Korean, his friend, one Korean pastor went to the Kampong Som Bible School in Cambodia, and then he got sick after 6 months. So he came back, he introduced me to him. So there is, I say, okay, I'm going to Cambodia then. And then I look at the internet, oh, Cambodia is a scary place. So I start lying to him, say, Moksanim, when you're going, I say, oh, I have some guests from the US, you know, about 2 weeks, you know, after leaving, I make this, and then after 2 weeks, he said, when you going? I said, oh, I'm sick. So I start lying to him. So it's been 6 months, I start lying to him because I'm scared to go to Korea. 몸은 타는데, 아니, 마음은 타는데 몸이 안 가죠. My heart going, but my body won't let go. So after 6 months, I didn't have a choice. No more excuse for it already. Yeah? So there is now, I went to Cambodia. When I went to Cambodia, before I went to Cambodia, I emailed to the Bible school, the minister, 총장님, yeah? In the Bible school, I wrote, I said, I'd like to donate my life for 1 month to Bible school, can you accept me? And he said, are you Christian? I said, yes, I'm an allegiant, I lied to him. I said, 내가 저기 장로님이라고 거짓말시켰어요. So I went. And after 2-3 days later, I got busted. The way I had. 내가 사실 존나게 힘들었어요. You know that kind of language that I use? So he catch me and he say, no, you go back to Korea. You're not belonging here. But when he told me that, honestly, I feel like slap his head, you know? And beat up all the missionary there. We had about 10 missionary work with us together. I was teacher for living education teacher. And then I went in my room, you know, the mission house, and I punched the wall. I get so angry, and I pray, and God answered to me. God said, do one day at a time. 48 hours too long for me. It was real hard, you know. And he said, and I feel like he kicking me out right now. And I can hear myself, I walk here myself, I wouldn't walk out myself. And I don't have no place for go. So next day I told Mokchan, I'm not going. And then he said, why? He said, God sent me here, so if you want me to go, you pray to God, that the God tells me, I will be anything. Well, actually, he wanted to hear that, you know. Not too long ago, me and my wife went over there, and I told him that, Mokchan, you want to try to kick me out before, what if, you know, I slap you or punch you or something, and then I said, well, you know, you didn't go because God sent you. And because you want to be missionary, that's what process you got to go through. So I really thanks to him. And one day, I told you Chuck Lee then, hey, he scolded me, I eating too much. I was crying, you know, like in the spoon, on the rice top, and my tear dropped into the rice, I was eating that. And even that, I still never leave. You know, even though he's, and he told me, are you gonna, you eat too much? I said, you know, I'm a big guy, you know. I eat more like you guys, I'm gonna die. You know, please, you know. I was sad when I said that. I feel like I'm the lowest person in the world. And then he told me, okay, from tomorrow, are you gonna eat a lot like now? I said, no, I'm not gonna eat a lot. And then I didn't eat a lot, but I didn't say no, I still had extra hamburger. $1 hamburger, I had two I carry every day, I was so hungry. Yeah? And when I was over there, 1 month, and that was important. After 1 month, two more weeks I was there, extra 2 more weeks, because they had a big revival. And I know they need me, so I told Mokchan, now I leave him tomorrow, and I'm not coming back. And reason I came here, because our student. And what students say is most carry, not the missionaries say. Because all the missionaries, they reading me every day. They tell Mokchan, he did that, he did that. So I thought, everybody don't like me, eh? It's okay, I'm never like them too, you know? So and then Mokchan, you're right, what the students say is right. So when I went back to the school, I tell all the students, they hate me too, because I make them do something that they never done in their life. I make them exercise 5 o'clock in the morning, make sure go class, you know, right on time, make sure 2 times a week, room inspection, what? Just like prison, eh? So, yeah, I made all that, but they never like follow that, because they never done that before in their life, just different culture, but I forced them. So one time I took out my shirt out, I told them, I'll fight one against one, because they're not listening to me. So I told them, hey, let's fight one by one, and then if you guys beat me, I'm going back to Korea. Or if I beat you, follow the rule. So they're all like conspiracy, right? But nobody came lucky. So anyway, the day I leave, and I told all my students, say, hey, I want you guys to give me one valuation of my life, because nobody valued my life before. So I told them, you don't have to write, you don't have to put your name, but if you write, just write true about me. Last 6 weeks I was here. So 55 students, 47, the letter I got in my mailbox after like half an hour later. But when I look at the letter, oh, it's very emotional. Yeah, that's true. Beginning, they always hate me. They say, hey, you know, who you come over here telling us what to do? Even my parents never not telling us what to do, what you telling me. So, you know, we never like you. But in the middle, they say, oh, only you, the missionary, make us do this. We need this. Because after they graduate from the Bible school, when they go to the real society, be one pastor or work for one Korean missionary or somebody, they have to have a living education. Huh? Yaksok, you know, all that. If they don't make it, they're not gonna make it. Okay, so in the third, thank you for coming. We need you. Thank you. And And then they said, please come back. We need you. In the last minute, they said, before you come back, study Bible more. So mostly the letter was like that. So when I saw that, wow, I was shocked and I was crying. Well, this guy, they need me and they love me. I didn't know that. So I went back to the Moksanin, this the letter other student wrote. So can you write my letter for one day leave, the old man, the Moksanin, for me, valuation. And then can you read whatever other student said? And then he hold my hand and said, I don't need to read, I already know. They were very emotional. So he went back, he wrote one letter to the Moksanin, and then I took the letter, and then when I was coming to the airplane, first class, I had a lot of mileage, so I came first class. In the first class, I couldn't eat nothing, because I lost maybe like 20 pounds, I think. And when I was sitting down in Jeddah, I saw the other blood on the chair, in the seat. I was bleeding. When I was working 6 weeks, I thought only 6 week life. So I give a whole my, you know, everything I give. You know, I give my body, my mind. Sometimes I didn't even sleep 2-3 days when I was working. That's why. So when I came back to Korea, and then my wife waited for me in the airport. She saw me. She shocked, you know, because I saw change. I look best. And then me and my wife went to see the Moksanim. Moksanim see me, he was crying. He said, what have you been, what you did over there? Like, why you look like that? I said, well, Moksanim, you know. And then I showed him the letter. And then Moksanim read it. Or the letter, you know, I seen it on the side. Oh, the letter was very emotional. He said that Reverend Moses said that he was praying one person like me to come and help him the Bible, at the Bible school. But people like him being prisoned and God using him to write checks. So he was thinking all that good stuff about me. And I got the letter about him. And then after that, Moksanim told me, okay, go home and rest. Okay. That's the time when I went home, and that's the first time in my life I started look behind my life. And 2 weeks I stay home, I hardly even talk to her one word, because it made me feel guilty. All the life that I had was all wrong. And I feel so guilty. And all the Moksanim was teaching me Bible when I was in prison, all memory coming back. And I'm looking at I make the film, you know, the film for the Cambodian children, and the pictures and the letter, I'm looking at them. Oh, I cry every day I start crying. And my wife think I kind of like tepe kuku, because I'm not talking, I'm not eating, I just crying. But my wife, she owned the interior design. She had her own company. So she had to go work in the morning and she come in the evening. And then I realized that all the things that I did was sin, and I truly believe that God, why these children have to die in Cambodia? A lot of kids dying and they're sick and all that. Why they have to die? They didn't even do anything wrong. Actually, I supposed to die because all the things that I did wrong. And people think the children is dirty. They're not dirty. I'm dirty, you know, because they wear dirty clothes and they're sick. They're not dirty. So, you know, I'm thinking all that. And I still made me realizing is I have to pay back. You know, I have to pay back to Cambodian children because they helped me to look at behind my life, right? So I have to pay back. So I told my wife, hey, you know what, I think I gotta go to Cambodia back. I went back to Cambodia I like serve, help the Cambodian people 1 year. And then my wife said, no, you're not going. You know, and then also I told my mother, go to Thailand. So he introduced me one of the Moksanim from New York, and you know, sport, yeah, Huan. I never had no sport, I never had nothing. So all my mind, I don't care, I just like go, but you know, I have to have a sport, somebody support me, or fun sport and all that, I've never had. So Moksanim introduced me, one of the Moksanim from New York, and if I go to Thailand, they say they're gonna provide me car, the vehicle, and they're gonna support me every month, so much money and all that. I want good deal things, yeah. So, but I thinking, not Thailand, I go in Cambodia, because these Cambodian children will help me give my life back to Christ's life back way. So I told 목사님, hey, I went to Cambodia. He said, no, you're not going to. I said, I go. He said, even if you die in Cambodia, are you happy? I said, yeah. He said, okay, go for it. I will pray for you. So that's why I went to Cambodia. That's the picture that me and my wife, we had a final dinner in Korea, and we decided to go to Cambodia. We look pretty good, huh? those who left, I think we look better. Yeah? Dr. Lee. Yeah. That's the 목사님, Lee Won-tae. When I told him that, I like to go back to Hawaii, the time I met him again in Korea, and he told me, right now you're 49 years old, why you give up your life? When I met you in Hawaii first time, I was 49 years old. 20 years, I served the Lord, now I retire. You have leadership, you're healthy, and you can speak English, all that good. Why you want to give up your life? Even me, I have, you know, he's a very sick man. He have disease. And all that, I still the 20 years, I give the work for God. So don't give up. So he give me the courage. Yeah. He's just like my father. I talk to him every other day. He's still praying for me in Korea. That's me. Pretty boy, eh? Yeah. Cute boy. Yeah, I cannot even believe that that's me. Like a K-pop, eh? And this me was in prison. Ooh, yeah? Ooh. I've been many prison. And even though I have a small sentence, they sent me USP, maximum place in prison. This is when I was in the USP Lampak. And in the Lampak, this pretty bad, nasty place. I see people getting stabbed every day. Yeah, and we have to join the gang too. I have to be real tough. And I only had like 4 year sentence. Here I see people get 800 years, two time life, and all they never will get out of jail. Yeah, but yeah. That's the guy in the middle, he don't want to bring the drug in from Korea, first time in history. This old man name is Mr. Cha. He the president of Shinshin Enterprise. But he got life. He don't want to bring the now that everybody using the not cocaine, the ice, the methamphetamine speed. That's the guy who bring the first time from Korea. And he died in prison already. And this the guy in the left, from West End, he's from the New York, he's a hitman for Born to Kill, the Vietnamese gang. But he get killed too also in prison. But he was fighting some different gang in prison, and he got killed. And his gang, 125 people got indicted. They all got life. Pretty crazy, yeah? Crazy life. He's my roommate, yeah. He's my roommate, what? Yeah, he called me Hyungnim, and yeah, it was okay. Yeah, he have a strong heart, but when you pray with God, you get shot. When you pray with water, you get wet, right? When you pray with fire, you get burned. When you pray with crime, you go in jail. So when you pray with the God, God will send you heaven. That's what I'm doing right now. This is all my boys, my gang. They all stay in Korea, they all in Hawaii. Most of them, they are back in jail in Korea right now. They're showing the YouTube. This is the Kampong Song Bible School. This is the left side, is the girls' dormitory. Right side is the men's dormitory. And this is a pretty large side, you know. This is a pretty big the area. And this Bible school been there 20 years, almost 20 years now. They have about 25 village church. In the village, they went to the Kampong, that's the one of the church from the, yeah, from the Bible school. And just my Mokshanin, he don't want to scold me eating too much. Yeah. Well, wasn't for him, I wouldn't be here today also. Yeah, he's my teacher also. He don't want to taught me how to be missionary. So, yeah, I really thanks to him. And this is my Bible students. This is all my students. Now they all graduate now. I think about one third now they're still working for God, but rest of them they're not. So some over here, couple people, couple students here, they're working with me right now. My job is every Saturday, they have to go with me to the village and we have to help them leaving education. So this is, and every Sunday after the service, and we have to go up there and share the gospel to the people. And they don't want to do that, but I make them do that. And if they don't follow me, I kick them out. And there's a kind of, the village Cambodia is reality now. And every Monday to Friday, I will look around to the village and I find this kind of village, there are many, but, and I talk to the chief of village and I tell him that we're coming back in Thursday with all my students and let's we clean up. Oh, this the no more end, this kind of clean up. But someone have to do it. Someone have to do it. And there's a kind of village that we go, this is the one shoes factory workers living here. And so dirty and so smell, you see that they were gloves and mask and everything. And when I tell the student, clean up, they don't wanna clean up. I say, do it, they don't wanna do it. Okay, I'm the leader, just like Jesus. Jesus always was the front line. So I have to sacrifice just like, so I clean up with my hand, no glove on. Oh, they get maggot and all that, you know. Clean up, and then all the students, they follow me. And I even put Clorox in my hand, try to clean the smell. Smell don't go away. Sometimes get rash from the other rubbish. But that's the way I have to teach them. And some Korean church from Korea, I don't even know. They send me clothes. But they send me a lot of clothes like that. I take the clothes, I go to the village and help the village people and try to tell them God sent all their clothes. This rice bag, $60 one month. So I told the Changmunim, the Arijan, he put $30, I put $30. So we buy the bag and we give to village people. See, we give to village people, every family, one bag each. But we have to give them, buy them soil also. They cannot eat just rice. We have to give them some kind of ingredients. So it's not easy. And we go to the mountain, real mountain in the village. And these children, look at these children. And my student, when they come to Bible school, first time when they enter, they don't have no clothes, nothing. I mean, they have clothes on, but they don't have no extra. But all the missionary, the mission team come and they start giving them something, yeah? And they always have extra, and then the vacation time, they take them to the family. They give to the family, yeah? So I found out, I make one rule. They only can have so many socks, so many shirts, so many other there, and rest, I confiscate them. So I don't mean that when I say that. Yeah? So I take them to the village. So I take them to the village. This is a way down mountain. And these little children, right now in US, what they're supposed to be, play with Nintendo or, you know, the playground. And these children, they live in the mountain. And so hot over there, and so many mosquitoes, and so many bugs, and they get paid like $5 one month, cutting wood. So I go over there, cut their hair, medical treatment, and all that, and we doing that. And I give them this the can sardine, yeah? I make sure I give this girl more than anybody, give them more clothes. And this kid, when I give him rice, almost raw, he eating it. You know, he never eat rice. I don't know, he's so poor guy. So we give him, so he was happy. So the one bag of rice, like $30, already talked to $60, they get different quality, different price. And in my Bible school, we have 100 children, elementary school children. And you know, in the head, a lot of bug, you know? In the front of the forehead, they get little white spot like that. You know what is that? That's all the bug house. The other bug they living over there. Sometime before I cut the hair, I, you know, just take them out, and you see another bug around there, all bleeding. So that's all. And two times a week, we make sure, you know, they get, you know, the bug, some kind of chemical we spray and give them back. And nobody done that before in their school. And me, the first guy, I make them do that. So I made a mistake. I cut his hair, bullet head. My mission Oh, okay, sorry. That time my wife used to send me money while working, and then I never had no sport, nothing, no. And other thing, I knew some my gangster friend or some people from the U.S. They found out that I stay in Cambodia. You know what they said? They said, "Well, we guarantee the guy not gonna make it." They're betting each other. They said, "How can this guy go, you know, the foreign country today? We know he will come back in 3 months." "Oh, no, no, 5 months he'll come back." So when I heard that, makes me very angry, but makes me strong. Makes me strong. And then I buy them, every 3 months, I buy them slipper. So one slipper costs $1, but now like $1.50 now. So all the children have the slipper. Looking good, huh?
Yeah,
look good, look good. So every time, every Saturday, we go to the village and we like to have a program with the children. A lot of people, they throw a rocket us because we teach them gospel song and stuff. The parents, they're all Buddhas, right? So they are making trouble. So we take the school truck and we bring like 100, 200 children to our the Bible school, and we have a good program, have a good time and all that. But when we give them vitamin or medicine, they don't know how to use it. You know, like we give them toothpaste, how the toothpaste tastes? Good, yeah? So they start eating the toothpaste. Well, I used to eat it too when I was a young kid. So when you get, we get donated the vitamin, we have to teach them how to use. Or sometimes I give to village, chief of village, and let them give one day at a time, whatnot. Because when they eat the vitamin and vitamin tastes good, they will eat whole thing. And this the village that we go to, we have to ride the boat like 2 hours. And the village is way in the mountain. And then we go into the village and we help them clean the village and all that. And then when they want to give us reward, you know what they give us? They give us monkey, or sometimes they give us snake or frog and stuff. They give us reward for that. And this is the water that they're drinking. Yeah. I mean, try to drink too, but a couple of sip I drink and the thing like coming out of it and smell nasty. And you know what water is the best, they say? Rainwater. They get the big jar, and when the rain come to the roof, and then they drink the rainwater, but in the rainwater, they get the mosquito egg and other bug, and they drink that too. This water from the ground, groundwater is the worst water. You shouldn't drink that because it's chemical inside. And even though you have a water filter, you clean, and you know what? That chemical doesn't go away. So this water that people drink. Tastes good, yeah? There's the cockroach that they're eating. And I seen my step when they eat the cockroach, all the gas coming out, yeah? Tastes good, they eat this, how they eat it. They say this cockroach is a clean cockroach because they live in clean place. Maybe you should try it when you come to Cambodia. And there's the frog. Look, not that bad, yeah? Yeah, there's a frog. That's how they eat it, the frog. And there's a snake that they eat it. Look at the frog they eat it. It's so small like that, they say eating it. Anything move, they eat. So when you see Cambodian people, don't move, just stand there. See, the kids, they go to the rain season, they go to the rice farm, and then they catch the snake and they sell them for like 50 cents for one frog, they sell them for 50 cents. The snake, they catch them in the mountain. They get a lot of snake up there. The children, they don't have a playground in Cambodia. And the smell nasty, you know, because the heat, you know, they smell nasty and they get all kind of disease and sick, skin rash. That's where they play. And probably this kid, they're looking for some kind of metal for sale, maybe can or something they're looking for sale. Don't you feel sorry? Yeah, sorry for them, yeah? Yeah. And this is my Bible school. And I'm the right side, way in the end, that's me. And I'm in charge of security, I'm in charge of everything. Before revival meeting, before the meeting start, I tell them all the rule that they have to follow. Otherwise, I kick them out also. And this kid, he always hang around by the rubbish can looking for paper or anything metal if they can sell. And you know what? This much metal, not even $1, but they're still looking for. And this is my student. I teach them how to grow things. Instead of just giving rice, I get some seed from Korea, and I teach them how to grow. It's all my student Bible school. And I give them, I give them maybe two students, one each of them, and I teach them how to grow. See, there's a cucumber, it's come out good. Cucumber and onion and only certain things come out good. Potato and sweet potato, they all we grow. And I make the soccer team, my Bible school student. I've never seen them win yet. And that's so when they graduate. And what do you mean? I wear in white because of I was in charge of cooking. All the cooking part I charged, so I couldn't wear the black and stuff. And this is so really emotional too. Our Bible school, they have a big water tank on the ground, and I see these children going over there, and one of the children always call me Papa. About six of them they're going, and they're not coming back. So we start over there, and then the kids, oh, you know, they're talking all that, and they're telling us that one of their boys called me Daddy, he stayed drowning in the water. So I told my student, go over there, go find him, and the water is pretty deep, they couldn't find him, but we did find him. And then the boy bringing the kid, this like frog, grabbing dead frog, grabbing leg, you know, bringing him. And then I told him, hey, I was kind of shy, hey, take him to the hospital, hurry up, take him to the truck. You know what he do? He just drove in the truck. And then we take him to the hospital, of course he died. And then this is our, in the school, our one of the neighbor house that the boy lived. And then we put the body on the bench, the wood bench. And next day morning, we put one white sheet, but next day morning I make this box. We made them, and I went over there. I took the sheet out. When I see the face, I don't think you guys remember that. And all the maggots coming out from here, you know, any hole, you know, through the hole, you know, all the maggots around, you know, all that. So we put the kid in there, and I take him to the mountain. I had this box on my shoulder, all the liquid coming out from the, you know, the body liquid. And the smell is so nasty, so we have to spray them. So we take him to the mountain, and I bury him. After I bury him, and his friends, they come around and bury him, help bury him also. And that's the one of the brother. I don't know what he's praying for, but he's so emotional. And over there, the children die, but the parents, they don't have no emotional. They die, they just die, they just make one more. You know, this their attitude. I see a lot of kids die, and I see some people sick and die. So we always make the box and take them. We take them to the mountain and we bury them. And over there, the children, mostly they don't have parents, or some children, they have parents. So, but they don't play with the kids. So this girl, a lot of brothers, she's a mother of their sisters, you know? She don't have any time. They always gotta take care like that, you know. They're very sorry for you. You see this kid leg? Get all the mosquito and ant spite. I tell you, this make you itchy for 6 months. It's real, real bad. I had them in my back, 6 bites. And 6 months, the pus coming out every morning. My wife used to do that. In Cambodia, it's real bad like that. And just like me, everybody call me doctor. I give them this kind of medical treatment. And over there, always hot. You see my shirt? Always hot over there. I look good, yeah, in this picture. I'm really, really, really happy. And I really thanks to God that God gives me a job. Before, when I was in Hawaii, I had a job doing crime. But payback is to go to jail or get killed. But this job gives me standing here today and meet lovely people to God. Right along, yeah? Yeah. And this kid is 22 years old. Look how small. No more vitamin in their body. So they don't grow. So I give her $5. I find her in village. You know who's this guy, yeah? This guy Eddie and Mr. Cho. Let me tell you about a story about how I met Eddie. 1990, Eddie became FBI. So Washington D.C., they sent him to Hawaii to catch me. So he was Tom and I was Jerry. But you all know Jerry is more smart, right? Because me, for me, one mistake, I go down. So him, if he mistake for catch me, he can do again. But yeah, so he came down there to catch me. So he got close to me. So I knew this guy get close to me. Yeah, I tell you, I have more experience than him. I have more experience street life than him, right? So he came, and then he always talk nice, you know, befriend, all there, right? So you know, I said, okay, I befriend. And so he told me, we go drink. Maybe he like make me drunk, and maybe we talk about that. I don't know, maybe he get recording, I don't know. You know what I mean? And I never trust this guy. But so we start making friends, we go around. But somehow he from Miami, that no more Asian in the school, he told me, when he's to high school. So you know, he got slant eye, eh? So all the school students used to picking on him. But when he came to Hawaii, he was so happy because of all the Asian. I know him, who his girlfriend and everything. I don't want to say that. That time. He bought one girlfriend from Miami too. But after he see, anyway, me and he came good friend, but I never trust this guy. And then one day, he cried to me. He said, hey, I better become policeman. That way I can stay with you more, I can help you more. But because I'm mafia, my office gives me so much stress to arrest you. So I like quit this job to become police. So I said, hey, don't do that. If I do something wrong, you have to catch me, you have to arrest me. But he didn't. In my house, I get a grenade and I get a shotgun and all that, but he was playing with him, but he never catch me. He didn't arrest me anyway. And then one day, he told me, hey, he was crying again. And he said, hey, I get suspended because of you. Because of you, I got suspended 2 weeks without pay. Because when the FBI, when they become FBI, they get like 2 year probation, I heard, yeah? So he said, whether I don't quit or I leave Hawaii. So I said, well, better you leave Hawaii. Keep the job, huh? Keep the job for help the Korean people, huh? So he left. Ever since then, me and him, we didn't saw each other. But about 10 years later, I was running out of gambling house, I told you, yeah? In whole Hawaii, the Kapilani Kiamoku, there's on my street right there. And 2 o'clock in the morning, some of my security, they call me. They say, oh, boss, one Asian guy have gun, and he looking for you. He came to my gambling house, you know that? And I know he stay in Mainland, he stay down here somewhere, you know, California, somewhere. I said, who's that? He said, we don't know. You think we should pass him up? So I said, wait, don't do that. One by one, he said, shut. He said, no, we should pass him up because they are looking for you. So he told me, hey, boss, what's wrong? I said, hey, let him go. Matter of fact, I also on parole and probation also. I got to be careful, man. Next day, I went to the bar drinking. And then one pretty girl, she came to me, hey, Opa, hello. I said, hello. I said, Opa, one guy came here yesterday. And then he left one message. He know you come in here, so he give me one letter to give you. So I left, she give me one napkin, yeah? I left the letter. Hey, what's it here? Eddie. He said, hey, you know, I just had a honeymoon in Hawaii. I miss you so much, and I look at you. I think you're supposed to be with your wife. I'm not your girlfriend, you know what I mean? But anyway, and he left the telephone numbers and all that, and it's very emotional for me. He looking for me, you know? So I call him, and he said he's the LA that time, yeah? And then he said, I said, what kind of work you do? He said, he followed the Mexican mafia every day. So I said, oh, be careful, you know, all that? And I hang up the phone. And 7 years later, here I am in Cambodia. So one day, I was born in the mission hall, and I see Eddie's phone number, and I call him 7 years later. So I said, Eddie, I said, hey, long time, where you at? He said, I stay in Denver. I said, oh, okay. And he said, hey, what number is that? I said, well, I stay in Cambodia. He told me, oh, you must be in that gang. He mentioned some kind of gang. So I said, no, I'm not in that gang. He told me, what are you doing? What are you doing there then? I said, well, matter of fact, you know, that time I was in Cambodia, like, one year and a half I was around there. He said, I tell him, oh, I'm a missionary. He told me, oh, no, man, don't push it. I said, no, I came here for missionary, for real. You know, he said, oh, man, if you don't believe me, you look at my website. So I give him my website. And I guess he was looking at him the time that I was talking to him. And he said, you know what? Hang up the phone, I call you back. And then 2 days later, he called me, he said, hey, you know what? I'm coming down there. The check, I'm coming down there. You just wait for me. So I said, no, I go to Korea. Because I have to bring my wife and then, you know, to be missionary with me and my wife. And they said, okay, I meet you in Korea. So these two guys, they came to Korea, meet me, and then we went to Cambodia. And ever since then, even now, he supported me finance-wise. And I tell you, if I was one girl, I'd marry this guy. Nice guy. So when they came to, we went to the village in Cambodia, and they wasn't happy, I wasn't happy. The village was like, oh, mess up, you're dirty, and kids are there. So that's why Eddie's my friend. And wasn't for God, me and him, I don't think we can be this close. So I got more than I expected, way more, after I became missionary to God. I know God loves me, God gives me more than I thought. And you know what? I have to pay back. I have to pay back to my Moksanin, God, pay back to Eddie, also pay back to ACC. And you know what? Nothing is free in this world. I told you earlier, Dr. Lee, if you borrow money, if you don't pay back, what you do? We call the cops, we take them to the court, we make them pay, right? So whatever you owe, you have to pay. So I feel that Jesus died for me, and I owe my life to Jesus. And only way I can pay back to him is I have to give all my love and whatever I wish it, I want to give to Cambodia children. Even though I die in Cambodia, I know still not enough because he gave me so much love. And most of all, he will forgive all the sin I did. And he gave me one good job now. And I know you doctors, some of you doctors and all that, they're high position now, but you wait until you come heaven. I will be more high than you guys. So you guys got to kiss ass me now. So this is my friend Eddie. And when he went to Cambodia, when he was going on the way to Phnom Penh, we sleep one day and we catch a bus, we was going to Kampong Song, 5 Broadway. Guess what? The Cambodia, I think, is the most accident in the world, I think. The opposite, the truck and our bus, boom, bang. And then my bus, boom, tingles up, and then bang one truck and flip over on the hill. And me, Eddie, and Mr. Cho was there. And I see a couple of people, and the bone is all crushed to the middle. And you know what? The reason I say it is, so I told, I tell you, I got scared. And well, I tell you, Eddie got scared too. I said, Eddie, let's get out first. And the engine was still running, the grass was all dry, and I smelled the gas leaking. You know what they tell you, they're gonna expire any minute. But I tell you, we tried to break the bus at the window. I tell you, that was one strong. It's hard to break, you know. We tried to break them, and all the people crying and all crashing, all the blood all over. And I see the front windshield. The bus driver was like, you know, he was like knocked out, right? And I see the big windows like this big crushed. So I told him, go over there, the bus down. So he went bus. So me and him, we all got out, and we helped everybody got out. And I don't see Mr. Cho. Where's Mr. Cho? Mr. Cho was in the bus still, trying to help the couple people out. There's one gangster and FBI, chicken shed up, we run in. So we go back, so me and Mr. Cho, I told Eddie, disconnect the wire, because I want to kill the engine, right? Disconnect him. So somehow we disconnect him, and we're helping the two people, was all jammed up, you know, all broken leg and broken, two ladies. But when we were doing that, we need more help, people help, because we have to lift up the metals of, you know, the bend, we have to lift them up. And there's like 100 people on the road. I asked them, they are from the bus, and some people were driving, and, you know, they're looking at us. I told them, help, please help. You know what? Nobody can help. Cambodian people is without it. So me and Mr. Chong and Eddie came over there, we take them out bleeding, and other cars just passed by, so I stopped one car. And I took the passenger out, and I gave them $20, and I put the two ladies there. I told them, take them to the hospital, so they did. And me and Mr. Joe and Eddie, I still get scarred all over. Yeah, just the Cambodia. If you die on the street, and guys come out bleeding, everything, the little kid with the stick, they play around with you, guys probably. And take your watch or whatever. That's what Cambodia is right now. Okay, when my wife came back from Cambodia, when I told her, let's go to Cambodia, and she was crying, said, if I marry you, I thought I went to Hawaii. Not backward. So I told her, okay, you get two choices, whether you divorce me, or we get divorced, or we going to Cambodia. And I was serious. And I told her that if you and me get divorced, what's going to happen to you? So I, you know, give them the long story, what's going to happen to you. And if you go with me to Cambodia, and what's going to happen to you? And I told them that, trust me, I know I can do this, and I'm good in this. That's the one thing, I have a positive thinking, the positive word that I know I can do this. And we had the restaurant, and we had some bar before in Korea. I always told her that, I cannot handle this. I don't want to do this. I always tell them negative things. But this one, I say, I can do this. Because when I went to Cambodia, even now, I didn't go over there for leave. I sacrificed my life. If I want to leave, I will live in Hawaii. So me and my wife, I got out from the Bible school, and just stuff. We live in Phnom Penh with me and my wife, and came to Phnom Penh as, you know, work. But just like you in Africa, all by yourself, right in the middle of Africa. We never had no money. We never had, we cannot speak Cambodian. We don't know no road, no car, I mean, nobody, nothing. But God did us. Because my wife speaks Korean, and one of the girls was passing by our place that I live, and then she said, oh, you're Korean? Yeah, I'm Korean. Can you teach me Korean language? We said, okay. So we start from Ratana. The girl, Ratana was the first girl. We start, and then see what happened. That's my wife's student. They're learning Korean. All these students, they work in factory, but reason they're learning Korean, because they want to go work in Korea. They have to pass the exam. I look pretty bad, yeah? Because we have so much students, I talk to the landlord, I want to break the one room and make them big. So I couldn't hire anybody because no money, right? So I go on hammer, I just bust them out. Hey, you laugh, look at this now. I made them. Nice, huh? I made them like that. And then LCC bought us on the table when they came. Right, LCC? And we still have the table. So that's how we got them. And this is our staff in the school. Most of the students that my wife teach Korean, after they become good, and they be teacher too, we pay them. And then some of them, they go to Korea or whatnot. We have a Bible student too. And we have two husband and wife stay Kampong Chan. My wife teaching them. And our staff, Sangai, teaching Korean language. There's a Loa teaching Korean language. We have so many students. And there's the, what her name? She's the pastor teaching Bible. And there's another teaching English. There's the pastor Shin from Korea, like to work with us, so he teaching Korean. There's the Mark, Chinese guy, teaching music. And there's the Chie, Jipsanin, teaching Korean, teaching them how to cook the Korean, teach them the drama, you know, all the Korean culture, she teaching. And this guy, what his name is, the Filipino guy, he's a teacher from Philippines, but me and him, I met him in the gym, so every Saturday he teaching English, English class, without all pay. And this music teacher, every month, two times, come and teach music. And they get diploma like that. And I'm the principal in school. They have to pass the test. Oh, nobody clapping, yeah? And that's the certification we make. And you see In Song Kim over there, and I'm a one job in school, the principal. Oh. Yeah, medical mission. A lot of kids are sick, yeah? So I go Costco, I buy the medicine, and I give them treatment. And this girl, okay, me and Eddie and Mr. Joe, when they came to Cambodia, we went way in the mountain, and we see the two children came to us. One of them is her name is Sumbi, And one 6 months years old girl, then the mother bought. This girl, she couldn't even walk 2 steps because she had a big hole in the heart. A lot of Cambodia, a lot of children have a hole in their heart. They have a heart problem. Why? Because when the children was in my mother's stomach, 13 months, the mother's stomach make the lips, nose, eyes. By the time that they make the heart, the mother have to have a lot of vitamin in the body. But because of the food not enough, the mother, the stomach couldn't make the heart. So they get a lot of hospital. So her and the kid came, and then Eddie saw her and the another girl, zombie. They went back to the state. They came back to SEC. I think Dr. Lee told them, I don't know who told them, they like to see the record. There's no record over there. No, they say, oh, they like to see the children's record. And then, so I went go back to the beginning, the 6 months old girl, they died already. So really emotional. So I said, I didn't know that was so serious. So I took her to the Calamine Hospital. There's one hospital that owned by French people. And there's only one hospital, the hospital. I took her to over there. And you know what I told them? I told them, hey, can you help her have surgery? They said, no. Cost $8,000, whatnot. So I told them, we don't have money. So they said, no, cannot. So I told them, you guys believe in Buddhas. What Buddha mean? Love, right? I guess. But you guys have a right to live because you guys rich, and she have a right to die because she don't have money. And I don't even know her. So I cried to them, and I used the F word. I was so angry, I fight with the doctors and all that, and they all said, they all getting, oh, we're gonna call the police. I said, I don't care, you know? And you know, I was so sad, and I was so angry, I was like, little person in the world. I thought I was the biggest person in the world. Why? I cannot help her. So I was crying, I was angry. I'm not going. Until you guys help her, I ain't going. And I throw things out and oh, I make big, you know me, I big guy, loud voice. Eh? So when I was making them, I see one French guy walking. And French guy said, the guy from French. He said, what's going on? And I told him, who are you? He said, what happened? So I told him what happened. And you and me came here for the same purpose, help these people. And this, why this kid have to die? And you know what he said? He turned around and said, are you Christian? I said, yes, I'm Christian too. I said, who are you? He said, he's the minister, he's the number one man. So he said, he told the doctor, hey, you know what, this is, we took him to the November, year 2011. And then he told the doctor, hey, you know what, go to the process. We're gonna have her surgery, January 19th. So I took her down to January 19th. Now she getting surgery, free surgery. Okay? So this is the music teacher and the missionary and this girl working for Quaker organization. And she was the volunteer nurse. So we all praying and she had surgery. And we got her surgery. Now she can run. Now she big, but she can run today. So far, I did 14 heart surgery. Only heart surgery, we did 14 heart surgery. Similar to that. After she got her surgery, I got confidence. Oh, now, I took anybody have heart surgery, I take them to the hospital, and they all know already about me. So, hey, Mr. Kim, oh, missionary Kim, come here. What can I do for you? Oh, the children have a problem, all that. Hey, you know what? Okay, go ahead. So they have process, so we all get surgery free. Strong, eh? And even this lady, she's 45 years old lady, her heart was pumping, not pumping right. And she dying, any minute she dying. Even her, we got her free surgery. We got her surgery. See, after the surgery. After the surgery, we have to go send gospel now. That was the weapon. So when we went to her village, well, almost there, we took a Takeo village. We took about 3 hours to drive over there. We bought many bread, medical, and health commission. That's how we go all the time. When we went over there, oh, that village, almost whole village is the pagoda. So about 200, more than 200 old people waiting for me in the pagoda. So I go over there, I know, I'm sorry, pagoda, we cannot do anything in pagoda, yeah? They say, where? So they say, so we tell them, what about her house? So small, yeah? Went to her house, and then whole village people, they was walking about 30 minutes, they have met like 200 people, all the old people, they all come, oh, akun, akun chira, akun chira. The higher you go, more respect. So they all stay like the Arkansas. They told me, thank you for helper, thank you for helper. So I told her that, where's the chief of village? When the chief of village came, and the chief of village came, and I told him, you know what, we are Christian, and God will help her, all that, the procedure will go, and we'd like to send you gospel. It's okay, you accept us to serve the God here? They said, okay. So we started serving God. And this this village had one little girl. She's 15 years old. Oh, she had a heart problem. So we told the parent, hey, we'd like to help her. And you know what the parent said? No. I said, why? Because she got to get married. If she get heart surgery, she won't get scarred. She won't get scarred, so it's okay. Yeah? So I said, okay, I mean. So she had a big scar here. So the little girl mother don't want her daughter to have a scar because she got to get married. Does that make sense? Yeah. Even this kid, the heart, he have a 9 millimeter, the big hole he had. That's where he lived. The sun hit the house roof and become like fire. That's where he lived. We take him to the Korea after the surgery. Korea, Hyundai Asanbyeongwon, did his surgery. Look, now he's good, eh? So we sponsor him. Now he going to the international school now. First he said he want to be doctor, but after he went to school, now he said he want to be singer. Bing! So it's good. Hopefully, after he graduated high school, we recommended him to a Bible school. Came to Bible. So he will be one leader in Cambodia someday. And you know in Cambodia, you have to donate blood. Otherwise, they don't give you surgery. So I guess because of Buddha, I don't know, so I have to talk to the Korean church, the young kids. Yeah? I lied to them. So make them come to the